Hi everybody, this is Lars Bemir, and welcome to my Love VFX course, in which I will talk about the creation of my fantasy short film Nook with Nook Studio. You can find the link to my short film in the description of this video. The whole course will be focused on the compositing side of my short film, but in the first three lessons, I will talk about the pre-production and production of this project. In the first lesson of the course, I will talk about the creature design and look development of my fantasy creature Nook. Please keep in mind that everything I'm about to show you is the way I approach this personal project, and I'm not claiming that the way I finish this project is the only and right way to do it, which means there are many ways to get the job done. The most difficult thing about this project was to let it go at some point, because you never really want to stop working on your shots. Many years ago, I saw a VFX breakdown of a horror movie that is called Don't Be Afraid of the Dark, which had very interesting CG creatures in it. That breakdown inspired me to come up with my own story and fantasy creature for a personal short film project. About 2 years ago, I finally decided that it was the right time to start working on it. I didn't want it to be some random made-up story, so I started looking at Northern European mythology. It didn't take me long until I found the fable of the Nook, which is a water ghost that lures young girls into his water world with the sound of his harp or violin. In my short film, I left out the part with the instrument and the Nook playing music on it, but I stuck to the idea of the water ghost luring a young girl into his water world. In addition to that, I wanted to tell the story of a family that is breaking apart, which was the motivation for the girl to run away from home. Now, I'm going to start talking about the design of my version of Nook. I definitely took older artwork of this character as an inspiration for my design. There is an illustration of him from 1934, where he looks like a mix between a frog and a human, or another drawing from 1904, where you can only see his eyes and forehead peeking out of the water, which is an image that you can also see in the last shot of my short film. For my version of Nook, I use the phenomenon that is called pareidolia, that lets humans see faces in clouds, patterns, photos, and so on. I learned to use this technique from an awesome creature designer called Neville Page. This technique is very simple but also genius, because it can help you to come up with creature designs in a matter of seconds. You only need a cell phone with a photo app that allows you to reflect your image vertically from the middle of your frame. Then you would just need to find interesting patterns with this photo app that would look like faces or creatures to you. Neville Page suggested to take photos of animal skulls from hunted animals that are hanging on walls. On a trip to Austria, where you can see a lot of these animal skulls on walls in hotels and restaurants, I took a few photos of these skulls, which helped me to come up with some designs, but in the end I was just taking photos of my own mood board to come up with the final concept design of the creature. Although I am a senior compositor, I have been working on character designs and character animation in my spare time for over 10 years now. Taking my concept art and transforming it into a 3D creature in ZBrush was a lot of fun. I started by sculpting the head with the help of my Photobash concept and used Z-spheres and ZBrush to create his body. Once I finished the main sculpt of his face and body, I did the retopology in Maya, took the model back into ZBrush, and started to add details like wrinkles, warts, and scars on him to add some age and mystery to his appearance. It took me a few months to finish the 3D geometry for the Nook, from a rough sculpt of his head to the finished model. But I was really happy with the result, because I knew that another texture-based layer of skin details from Mari would help to make him look even more realistic. Being able to create the texture for this model in a node-based workflow was a joy. I could even take advantage of Mari's ability to build up my node trees from top to bottom, like I'm used to work in Nook. Instead of using the classic shading and look depth workflow of working from left to right, it may not sound like a big deal, but if you're coming from a background in compositing with Nook, it can help you to feel right at home. I created the UV layout of the base mesh in Maya, which is made out of 3 UV tiles. When you're creating a UV layout for your 3D model, you should try to maintain a uniform scaling, so that procedurally created textures that you might want to work with are not small in one area and huge in another area. In this case, I did not quite follow this rule, because I wanted to have a bit more resolution in the face, while sticking to only 3 UV tiles, but at least you can see a falloff of texture resolution from the top to the bottom of the model. Before I get into these textures that I created in Mari, I have to mention that I am not a texturing or a Mari expert. If you are interested in learning how to use Mari, there are 3 online resources that I can highly recommend when it comes to texturing. The YouTube channel Artruism Digital, which has awesome and high quality content, and the YouTube channel Campy3D, which is the channel of the developer who is behind the Mari extension pack. This extension pack for Mari is definitely worth the investment if you are interested in expanding Mari's set of tools and make it even more powerful. with features like the pattern engine, the customizable marking menus, or the huge library of tutorials that explain how to use the extension pack's awesome features. I will leave a link to these online resources in the description of this video. Another online resource that I can highly recommend when it comes to high-quality skin textures is the website texturing.xyz. The quality of their textures is amazing, and their products are being used in the commercial, game, and feature film industry. All of the textures that I have used for the skin textures of my creature are from texturing.xyz. I will leave the links to the three texture packs from texturing.xyz that I have used in this project in the description of this video. Although I've been using Mari for a few years now, I'm still learning how to use this tool, and I'm excited to learn new workflows with every project I'm using it for. I created three textures for this model and modified the displacement map a bit, which I had previously rendered out of ZBrush. All I did to the displacement map in Mari was just tweaking it a bit with a grade node to give it some more contrast and make it a bit darker. The diffuse texture starts with a mix of a skin texture and a displacement map, which I'm using to give the diffuse texture a bit more depth. After that, I added some noise nodes to make the skin look a bit older. And at the end of the diffuse texture, I added even more noise and masked noise areas to make the skin look even dirtier. One thing I did in this Mari project is something that I will avoid in future projects, which is having the same texture copied all over my node tree. Nowadays, I would use the radio node system that comes with Mari's extension pack, which helps you to send data from one point in the node graph to another without having the node connections going over your node tree. That way you don't need to worry about the complexity of your node tree as much, since it allows you to use less visible node connections. It's similar to the Nukipedia tool Stamps, which you should also check out if you are a compositor and you haven't heard of it yet. I'll leave a link to the Stamps tool for Nuk and a tutorial for the radio node system of Mari's extension pack in the description of this video. For my glossiness texture, I just use a noise texture that I have originally created for my diffuse map, and then I added a layer of white drops and painted areas, which I created to have some areas on the model that are a bit rougher and some areas that are highly reflective. The bump texture was painted with a bunch of photos of skin detail, and if we take a look at the V-Ray material at the bottom and take a closer look at the face, you can see the amount of skin detail that the bump texture adds to the whole model. That was it for the texturing part of my creature's base mesh in Mari. Now I'm going to give you an overview of the shading and look development of this creature with V-Ray for Maya. Okay, so here we are in Maya. In the last part of this video, I'm going to talk about the material of the creature's body and the material of the green reflection in its eyes. I believe these two shaders are the most interesting ones when it comes to this creature. The other shaders for the gums, teeth, and eyes are just regular V-Ray materials with diffuse textures and modified reflection or refraction settings. I've been working with V-Ray for over 10 years now, and I've always loved the look you can achieve with their subsurface scattering shader, which is why I have also used it for this project. For the body material of the creature, I took a V-Ray Fast SSS 2 shader and plucked the three textures from Mari into the shader, along with some color corrections and a layer texture node. If we take a look at the diffuse texture, we can see that the creature gets the green color of its skin from a mix of the original diffuse texture and two color corrected versions of it. The first color-corrected version of the texture is going into the diffuse color input, the second color-corrected version of the texture is going into the subsurface color input, and the untouched version of the diffuse texture is going into the scatter color input. As you can expect, I plugged the bump texture into the bump map input, and finally I plugged the slightly modified version of the glossy texture into the specular color and the specular glossiness input. It took me quite a while to finish the skin shader for my creature. And even though the textures that I created in Mari already gave me a good direction for the look of the shader, it was just a trial and error process until I was happy with the result. The shader for the green reflection in the creature's eyes is a mix of two ramp nodes with a circular ramp, a noise node, two layered texture nodes, and a color correct node at the end to adjust the contrast of this procedural texture. This texture is just plugged into the V-Ray Materials opacity map input. The diffuse color is set to white, and the self-illumination is set to a color that gives the eyes this very bright and green look. Normally, you would only see glowing eyes in the dark if you would be shining a light into an eye of a human or an animal. But in this case, I went with a self-illuminating shader to just get the look I wanted, which is independent from the light in the scene. I created the hair for the creature with Yeti, which is an awesome hair, feather, and geometry scattering plugin for Maya. If you want to know more about that plugin, you can check out my Yeti for Maya tutorial that I created a while ago. I'll leave a link to that tutorial in the description of this video. Alright, that was it for the first lesson. In the next lesson, I will talk about the rigging of my creature and the previous animation of my fantasy short film Nuk. Feel free to post any questions you have about my work in the comments, and I'll do my best to answer all of your questions. If you want to see more of these videos, don't forget to subscribe. Again, this is Lars Vemir. Thank you for watching, and goodbye, everybody.